Institute is equipping effective advocates for family stability and love, both at home and in the public square. You can be better informed, more motivated, and more effective. Subscribe to our fact-filled newsletter, participate in our book clubs, attend a workshop, and of course, you're tuned into our podcasts. Dr. J is once again Todd Wilkins' guest on Issues, Etc. They're discussing big business, Pride Month, the sexual revolution's grand narrative, and a recent study on women's happiness.
Since it is Pride Month, The View is celebrating pioneers in the LGBTQ plus community with our Pride Month FYI. Today we honor the first openly gay politician elected into the U.S. Senate, Ms. Tammy Baldwin, who also made history by becoming the first woman in Wisconsin to ever become a senator. She's born and raised in Wisconsin. She's a trailblazer who never hid who she was. She climbed the political ladder and recently helped introduce the Bipartisan Equality Act to stop discrimination against the LGBTQ plus community, which passed in the House last month.
That's Whoopi Goldberg speaking on ABC's The View this morning about Pride Month. This seems to be pretty much the uniform uniting factor in our country today. Whether you're a big business, a politician, a sports organization, you could be Budweiser. I think I saw probably at least a dozen various Pride-themed advertisements recently as the month began. The one thing that holds us all together, we're all proud of people who are in the LGBTQ, and as Whoopi Goldberg said, plus community. But what is the grand narrative behind Pride Month? Greetings and welcome to Issues Etc. live on this Monday afternoon, June the 10th. I'm Todd Wilkin. Thanks for tuning us in. We're going to be talking about two issues with Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse. Gay Pride Month and its grand narrative, and a new study on the happiness of single women with no children. Surprise, surprise, the study says single women with no children live longer, are much happier, and that marriage will kill you if you dare to engage in it. We'll find out about that research and whether or not it can be believed. Joining us to talk about Gay Pride Month and a new study on the happiness of single women with no children, Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. She taught economics for 15 years at Yale and George Mason Universities. She's a senior research fellow in economics for the Acton Institute and author of several books, including her latest, The Sexual State. Jen, welcome back.
Hey, thanks for having me on, Todd. I've missed talking to you guys.
We sometimes boil these things down to the narrative for the various things we look at, the sexual revolution, abortion rights, all that kind of thing. What is the grand narrative for LGBTQ pride?
Well, I think the grand narrative for LGBT community has, I would say, 3 points. Number one, everybody who experiences same-sex attraction was born gay. Everybody's born that way. Number two, sexual minorities, whoever they may be, sexual minorities cannot change. They can't live an abstinent lifestyle. They can't live a heterosexual lifestyle. And finally, embracing their LGBT identity and being sexually active is the only healthy choice for them. So that's the grand narrative. Anybody who doesn't fit into that narrative is a non-person and doesn't get a platform.
So why do you think there has been this almost en masse corporate buy-in into Pride Month?
Oh, you mean why is big business buying into this?
Why is Budweiser suddenly celebrating Pride Month?
That's a great question. The truth is, though, Todd, if you look back, you will see that big business has not been favorable towards the family, what you and I would consider the traditional values of the family. They haven't been favorable towards that in a long time. For the most part, they are pro-abortion. You never hear a peep out of them about divorce, there being any problem with divorce. You don't hear much about them out of them about pornography, any of the kinds of things that would be of concern to traditional Catholics or traditional Lutherans or anybody really who embraces traditional Christian sexual morality. Big business has given up on that a long time ago. And that's one of the questions that I answer in the sexual state. Why is that? And I think it's because the grand narrative of the sexual revolution overall is something that big business has committed itself to and is making money from. They wouldn't have to be doing that, but they have in fact chosen to do that. And I think part of it has to do with their own sexual indulgence, you know, and their desire that they don't want anybody to tell them anything's wrong. And plus families that have elements of brokenness to them, that people are more desperate for jobs. The little economy of the family isn't as robust as it once was. And so therefore women kind of have to work. Whereas before, women and men could cooperate between themselves and have their own little economy going. They don't need business in the same way as they do if nobody's sure that dad and mom are going to stay together, so I better keep my job just to be sure, just in case, kind of a thing. Everybody's vulnerable. And the business sector, or the employers in a general way, benefit from that insecurity that keeps people driven into the market. So you take those pieces together and you put them together and you've got this kind of, as you say, en masse, big business embrace of the sexual revolution for the most part. You know, of course you can find noble exceptions, but for the most part, that's what we're looking at. And it's certainly true on the LGBT front, you know, that it seems to be very cheap for big business to say, yes, we embrace Pride Month.
To what degree is Pride Month not as much about pride in one's sexual orientation, but really about shaming those who do not buy into the LGBTQ agenda?
Well, that's an interesting question, whether those two things can even be really separated at this point in time, you know, because there's something fundamentally irrational about the whole of the sexual revolution. And saying that there's no difference between being gay and straight, saying that everybody's born that way and that people don't have any choices, there are so many things that are empirically observable that are wrong with that set of claims. You know, the grand narrative is not really very robust. You know, there are lots of counterexamples. There are lots of people who will raise their hand and say, you know, gee, I changed. I made different choices. I'm not living that lifestyle anymore. I'm less crazy now than I was when I was doing all that stuff. You know, you can find a lot of counterexamples to that. And those people disrupt the narrative. And so they have to be suppressed. So on the one hand, what you've got is a kind of pincer movement, you know, to elevate those who agree with the grand narrative and to shame and marginalize those who do not. And that's because I think fundamentally the grand narrative is itself false. The sweeping generalizations that have always been part of the sexual revolution, they're unsustainable. And so not only in this area, but really in any other area of the sexual revolution you can think of, you have this same kind of process of marginalizing, deplatforming, silencing people whose lives do not fit the grand narrative. And I talk about that, this article that I wrote for the Daily Signal, I talk about that, you know, kind of give example after example of how that's been the case.
So you have written recently about some stories you are simply not going to read about in the mainstream press, especially coming in the aftermath, as you note, the anniversary, June 12th, the third anniversary of the Pulse gay nightclub mass shooting.
Right.
What was going on
right
there?
Well, you know, the interesting thing about the Pulse nightclub shooting is that, you know, of course, it was a gay nightclub. We all know that. We've all been endlessly schooled on the fact that this is proof of homophobia and so on and so forth. But what you never hear is that there were men in that nightclub during that melee, during all of that chaos. There were men who gave their lives to Christ in the midst of all of that. One guy, whom I quote in my story here, Angel Colon, I mean, literally, he's laying there praying, you know, Lord, if you get me out of here, I'm going to follow you. Another guy named Luis Ruiz, after it was over, you know, he had been injured and, you know, taken to the hospital and stuff. And he's just, in the weeks that followed, just going, you know, what am I doing? I got to get out of this thing, you know. And so those two men have both been part of the Freedom March, which has been, they just had their second Freedom March. People who were once part of the LGBT community, who have left that community, who are living Christ-centered lives. Some of them had therapy. Some of them did not have therapy. Some of them just had radical encounters with the love of Christ. But they're living different lives now. And they have formed the Freedom March as an alternative. I wouldn't say it's exactly an alternative, but it's meant to say, hey, we're here too. Here's our parade. You know, they don't have corporate sponsors like the gay pride parades do, you know, but they're there. And they're trying to say, we're here. We count also. Our stories matter. And as a matter of fact, they're too polite to say this, but the fact is their story is a thorn in the side to the gay establishment. And of course, that's why they have to be deplatformed all the time.
If the sexual revolution were true to its word, this kind of to each his or her, or depending on what a pronoun you want to use, own, if they were true to their word on to each his own, they wouldn't have any problem with stories like those two being told, would they?
Well, that's right. That's right. Because the idea that it's all about choice and self-expression and really understand being your true self, that has always been kind of the front for the sexual revolution, because that's the cover under which they smuggle a set of ideas that are really quite indefensible if you took them on their own merit, you know. So abortion is a very good way to look at that. They talk about women's right to choose. Well, Christian people provide an alternative choice to people, to women in crisis pregnancies, by offering them baby clothes and counseling and help getting jobs and help getting apartments and all that stuff. That's what crisis pregnancy centers do. And the so-called pro-choice people want to shut all that down, you know, because those ladies with their baby clothes, that's an affront. It's a slap in the face to the whole narrative. You'd think they'd be in favor of choice and information and lots of options, but no, they've never been in favor of that. And Tom, that's why I think there's something deeper afoot with the whole sexual revolution. And I think that deeper something is that the sexual revolutionaries resent the human body and the constraints that the human body places on our sexual activity. The fact is, sex makes babies, and when you have a baby, you have responsibilities to that child, and people don't want to live up to those responsibilities, and they still want to have sex, you know? And so the grand narrative of the sexual revolution, the overall grand narrative, is to say that sex and babies can be and should be radically separated. That after all, kids don't really need their own parents, and so you can do whatever you want if you finally do have a child. And I think at the very bottom of it is the idea that they resent that men and women are different. The fact is, men and women are different. We are created by God as separate and different and complementary to each other. And the sexual revolutionaries, for their various reasons, they cannot stand that. And that's what's driving the gender ideology, in my opinion.
Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse is our guest on this Monday, June the 10th. We're talking about Gay Pride Month. In a minute, we will turn to a new study that claims that women who are single with no children and stay that way are happier over time and live longer. Jennifer is founder and president of the Ruth Institute and author of several books, including her latest, The Sexual State. Jennifer, to kind of put a bow on the gay pride conversation here, it strikes me that there are a lot of people who are feeling the pressure of this. And what they're choosing to do, I think, is either acquiesce, but the pressure is coming in a different form on some level, a legal level. That is, there are states that are banning any kind of what would be deemed as conversion therapy. I wish we had a better term than that, but a conversion therapy, so that people who are really struggling against their homosexuality or the other pressures of the sexual revolution are being told, you can't do that. There's no recourse for you. We are making it illegal, essentially, for you to make that attempt.
Well, that's yet another example of the narrative having to be propped up. Because, see, the fact is there are multiple pathways to developing a same-sex attraction. And serious people who study the matter seriously are aware that the way men enter into same-sex attraction is different from the way women often enter into same-sex attraction. There seem to be different correlates and different pathways and so on. And one of the things that's not unusual among women is to see women who've been sexually abused or had some kind of sexual assault in their lives. They become repelled by men and they seek their sexual gratification and affection with women. And we actually had a conference last month where we had several people who had in one way or another been part of the LGBT subculture and who were no longer part of that subculture. And there was a woman named Elizabeth Wanning, whom you should get on your program. She's a very interesting woman. She was once lived a lesbian lifestyle, and she basically reported that she knew of many women who had embraced a lesbian lifestyle because of having been abused. And she said, you know, look, flat out, women are victims of conversion therapy bans because the very thing they need to talk about what happened to them, you know, and many of these conversion therapy bans, legal bans on what can go on in the privacy of therapist's office, which is outrageous all by itself if you stop and think about it for a moment. She reports that some of these things are written in such a broad manner that to even discuss the fact that, gee, I was assaulted and, gee, men are repulsive to me because of that, but I really want to talk about what happened to me and why I feel the way I do and I don't like the way I feel and I want to feel some other way. You know, all of that is in question now as to whether that's legally permitted to be discussed inside the privacy of a therapist's office. And so Elizabeth Wanning is saying very, very clearly that women are being victimized by the grand gay narrative, which is essentially a gay male narrative. And that is one of the other very interesting features that's coming to the fore here is that LGBT pride, we're all supposed to be celebrating it, but the fact is there are some very serious rifts inside that, what you could call coalition of lesbians, women who don't like men very much, and gays, men who don't like women very much, and they're in a coalition together, somehow working together all the time. You know, that you might think there would be problems that would emerge in that kind of situation. And in fact, there are problems that are emerging, especially around the transgender issues. But you won't hear about that in the mainstream celebrations of Pride Month.
On another subject, I was reading recently a brief article about a behavioral scientist, Paul Dolan, professor of behavioral science at London School of Economics, who claims to have found data that supports the idea that women who remain single and childless live longer and live happier lives. What do you make of this?
Well, you know, when you first brought this to me, I thought, oh, criminy, another crazy study, you know, and fortunately, our friends at MercatorNet posted an article about that and quoted a guy, a professor that I know of, and you probably should know of him too, a professor at the University of Utah named Nicholas Wolfinger, who looked into this a little bit and looked at this guy's study. This guy, Dolan, looked at his study. And, you know, what he found was that there was a whole lot less there than meets the eye, that the report that came out of those London newspapers was greatly exaggerated, you could say. And in fact, the difference between the unhappiness in the different groups that he was quoting wasn't a very substantial difference, and he didn't even say whether it was statistically significant. So it's hard to know what to make of it, really. You know, once again, it looks like another sneak attack on the institution of marriage with data that, you know, might withstand scrutiny, but probably won't, because the article that you've got here is not giving you what you need to know to figure out whether it's going to withstand scrutiny. So
to me, it seems counterintuitive. I'm not a researcher, I'm not a social scientist, but to me, it seems counterintuitive that a woman who dies alone and childless, no matter how long she lives, is going to look back on her life and say, I did it my way and I wouldn't have done it any other way. I'm also not a woman, but it does seem counterintuitive to kind of the impulses that most normal women carry around with them about right. Their goals for life.
That's right. That's right. And you know, in general, married people live longer and are happier and have better sex lives. You know, in general, that's what the vast bulk of the data shows, you know. And the one thing that's a little different is that children do place stress on a marriage. You know, there's no doubt about that. Children are a big stressor, but they also tend to stabilize a marriage, because when you've got kids at stake, people tend to stick it out and work at it. And 5 years later, the problems have worked themselves out and so on. So that's also a very common finding that one has looking at a vast swath of data that has been done on both happiness, long life, sex lives, all those type of things. The other thing that seems to be in this guy's data, but which of course nobody said anything about, is the difference in parenthood. How do women view parenthood if they're married versus if they're single? Being an unmarried mother is a big stressor. Okay, so being a mother, in general, women like being mothers, but being an unmarried mother has a lot of stress associated with it. And that's something that you don't generally hear about, except, you know, our friends at the University of Virginia or University of Utah, who will talk about that sort of thing, you know?
Well, but that kind of raises a question, and that is there an assumption there that motherhood with or without father in the picture, are essentially equivalent to one another.
You see, that's the thing. I have noticed over the years, and I haven't tracked the happiness data that closely, okay, Todd? I have a little bit of happiness data in my book, The Sexual State. At the very beginning, I show data showing that women are less happy today than they were back in the dreaded 50s. So even with all the women's liberation and all of the rest of it, you have more women today reporting that they're unhappy or very unhappy today than you did, you know, 30, 40, 50 years ago. After all this so-called progress, gosh, isn't that something, that it hasn't really turned out to make people happy? So that's one factor. But I haven't tracked all of this work in detail, so I don't want to overstate what I know. But what I have seen, and I can report to you, is that one common trick of sexual revolutionaries is to group people together who really should be separated out. So, for instance, it used to be common knowledge and commonly found in the data that cohabiting couples would have more domestic violence than married couples. Okay, so there'd be a difference between whether you were legally married or not. Well, at some point, they stopped collecting the data in that form, and you start seeing, quote, intimate partner violence, which groups all those people together. Say it groups the dating couple and the cohabiting couple and the married couple, they're all grouped together. So now who does that help? It covers the unusually high violence that you see in the non-marital relations, and it mixes in the relatively safe marital relationship with the relatively dangerous non-committed relationships. And so that's what, you know, if you look at the data, often you'll see, if you're not careful, what you'll see is a shift at some point in the 90s, generally, where on one side of the line you were talking about married couples, on the other side of the line you were talking about intimate partners, you know, and it's apples and oranges, you know.
You would think that if the data was solid enough to support the fact that women who remain childless and unmarried throughout the span of their life end up living longer and being happier, you would think that the sexual revolution elites would opt for that lifestyle themselves. But as you pointed out, they don't. They usually live a lot like the, as you said, people did in the dreaded 50s.
Yes, that's right. That's right. It's very interesting that the college-educated professional classes, if you look at their statistics, they look like Ozzie and Harriet. You know, they get married, then they have kids, they tend to stay married. You know, all of those numbers are kind of like what was average for the pre-sexual revolutionary period. The difference is that college-educated elite class, they start their families about 10 years later. You know, they get married at a later age and have fewer children. But they're still getting married first and then having their babies. So they're living like Ozzie and Harriet, but they're bad-mouthing it all along. And I think the interesting thing that's going on there is that in order to be part of that college-educated managerial class, you have to postpone childbearing. And so a lot of those women have gone to college, lived in co-ed dorms, had sexually active lives, they've used contraception, may have had an abortion or two, and then they are entering into their professional lives. And so they enter that professional life, in a sense, dependent on or grateful to, or, you know, in some way indebted to, I think that would maybe be the right word, feeling indebted to the ideology that says you get to do whatever you want and get rid of the baby and it'll all be good. And by the way, we've got tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of dollars of college debt that we have to pay off. So bailing out and starting a family on one income is not a live option for a lot of people either. So it's kind of a trap that a lot of people are in, and it makes it harder for people to take a stand and say, you know what, this really stinks. It wasn't really all that fun in college, and it's kind of a mess now. And how do we end up with all this debt? And, you know, maybe grandma was right. It makes it harder for people to say that. Yeah, I don't say it's impossible. I'm not a determinist, as you know. Catholics aren't determinists, and I don't think Lutherans are either. But it makes it harder. You know, it puts kind of a weight, kind of a burden on people to say, to look over their shoulders and say, you know, this was a big mistake. But when you find somebody who says, you know, I was lied to, and this is a mess, that person, that's the person I want to talk to, and I want to have sign up at the Ruth Institute, because we need people who can tell that story and tell it convincingly. because that experience, the young people will listen to the voice of experience. They won't listen to the Bible. They won't listen to facts and figures, but they will listen to the voice of experience. So all you Lutheran Public Radio listeners, come over and see us at the Ruth Institute, because we want to hear from you. We want to hear that story. It's very important. Your testimony is very important.
Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse is founder and president of the Ruth Institute. She taught economics for 15 years at Yale and George Mason Universities. She's senior research fellow in economics for the Acton Institute and author of several books, including her latest, The Sexual State. You can find out more about the Ruth Institute and about her books at our website, issuesetc.org. Click Listen on Demand. Jen, thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
You've just been listening to Dr. J and Todd Wilkin discussing Pride Month, big business, how the grand narrative of the sexual revolution doesn't actually have a place for everyone, bids for power, and women's happiness on Issues, Etc. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization equipping effective advocates for family stability and love, both at home and in the public square. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. Like us on Facebook, check out the site, and subscribe to our weekly newsletter to stay informed.